In this video, we're taking a look at different business models that you can use in a SaaS startup to project and forecast your revenue going forward. And we'll particularly pay attention to the case where it's a new business or a new business line within an existing company and you don't have historical data to base your estimates off of. We're gonna look at what are the different ways to model going forward and what are the most common business models for SaaS companies out there. Ready to start? Let's dive straight in. Hi, my name is Dobry, this is Minty Analyst, and today we're taking a look at forecasting and projecting revenue for a SaaS business. Revenue projections are essential for any SaaS startup as they help with decision-making, provide for an effective planning, and also help with fundraising. By having a good estimate of your future revenue, you can better plan your sales and marketing expenses and the amount of capital you need to raise in order to meet your revenue goals. The biggest challenge when it comes to projecting revenue for a SaaS business is that the majority of SaaS startups are looking to revolutionize the way a specific thing is handled on the business side. So therefore, it's hard for them to find accurate historical data that they can use for their projections. This makes revenue forecasting even more important for a SaaS company or a SaaS startup. For example, if you overstate the percentage of visitors that you can convert to paying customers by running a paid ad campaign, you can have serious issues down the line because this would inform your entire P&L down the line. So you assume that you generate an X amount of revenue and you do that by converting an X percentage of your visitors and you need to spend an X amount to convert those visitors to paying customers so that you can generate this revenue at the top line. And the problem is that you're forecasting this amount of revenue being able to support this expense. And if it turns out that your percentage assumption for the conversion was wrong, then you have less revenue to support the exact same cost. And this can be problematic down the line as it would throw off your entire P&L and your entire projections going forward. Now that we know how critical accurate revenue projections are for any SaaS startup or an established SaaS business, let's go ahead and look at the different business models and different ways to forecast revenue that we can apply to make sure that we have a correct path going forward.
So let's start by exploring the two most common ways to forecast revenue. So you have the top-down approach and you have the bottom-up approach. I'm going to start with the top-down approach. It's more useful in cases where we have less of an idea of what you can do. So in this approach, we would start with the market size and then go down and figure out how much we can capture and what our revenue might be based off of that. For example, for our estimated market size, we have our base for 2022 at 4.3 billion. And we also Googled the market and found an article with multiple sources stating that it's expected to grow at an average of 16.6% CAGR over the next 10 years. We can apply this CAGR for each year, estimate the market size of each year. The next thing is how much we can capture from this market. And this is a function of two things. The first thing is if this is the total market for 2023, how much is our addressable market, our TAM, total addressable market? Here we can estimate that our addressable market, meaning the potential customers that we can access, is 5%, and then we have a rather conservative estimate that we're gonna convert 1% out of our total addressable market. So we have 5%, 1% of that is 0.05%. We expect this to grow over the next years, and this is usually something that you can discuss with your sales lead, the person that will be in charge of selling your product, or if that's you, you can do some research, read different articles about average numbers for SaaS businesses and specifically SaaS businesses in similar niches. Another thing that you can do is look at your competitors and what their market share was when they first started, what it is now, how it progressed over the years. So this is the top-down approach. We grab an estimate for the market size, we estimated our market share, and that's how we arrive at revenue. Then using our average revenue per client that we assume that we get down to our estimated active clients in each year. And from here on out, now that we have the revenue, We'll use this number to figure out the cost associated with bringing those clients on board, servicing them, etc., etc. So this is the top-down approach. Now let's look at the bottom-up approach, and let me know in the comments which one do you think yields better results, which one is preferred. The bottom-up approach, let's look at it from the perspective of the subscription business model. This is one of the most common business models for a SaaS product. So the idea is that the user signs up, pays a monthly, quarterly, or annual, or weekly, or whatever subscription. And this is a great business model because it allows you to estimate your annual recurring revenue, ARR, which is one of the most important metrics for a SaaS business. So the bottom-up approach, you can build it in various ways based off internal aspects of the business that you have some control over. Here, we decided to start by looking at the sales team, how many people will be employing that will be doing sales, what's their quota for new customers for each year. We assume a rather conservative 80% quota realization. We calculate the new onboarded clients, and it's also really important to add churn. Again, you can look it up on Google. I read in a few articles that the average churn percentage for a SaaS business is anywhere between 20 to 40% per year. A good idea, especially if it's like an initial model that you're building and you have no historical data, it's a good idea to go on the higher end of the bound. So I'll go with 35%, and those are the customers that will be churning each year, calculated as 35% of my total active clients for the previous year. Then we'll also introduce another aspect of the business models for SaaS business. So you can have a tiered business model, which means that there are different tiers, different prices that unlock different sets of features. So here we have three tiers, standard, pro, and business. The way I like to present those in any model is take the active clients, split them between the three tiers based of this estimated split that we're expecting. And you see here that I have a difference, and this is due to the rounding. I like to work with round numbers, especially when it's a number of clients. Then we have the annual charge for the different plans, and that's how we calculate our revenue. And this is a bottom-up approach because you start from something that's internal for the company and you build your way up to your revenue number. From here on down, you can rely on all those assumptions to build your cost part for the business. So let's say how much it would cost to staff this sales team, how much it would cost to onboard each client, marketing expenses, stuff like that. Do you have a specific onboarding process that adds more to the cost structure? Do you have additional costs for churning clients? All this you need to consider in the cost side of your P&L, and comparing it to the total revenue, you can figure out if it's a viable business. Another business model that is quite popular in SaaS products is freemium business model. This is when you have a free tier and then a paid version with more features or better support or something extra on top of what you're already providing. And the concept here is that you'll be signing up a lot of free users and being able to convert a portion of them to paid subscriptions. Here, we decided to start with our website visits. We apply 2% estimate free tier signup percentage, and this can be different for the next year. So let's say as you gain domain authority, you produce more content, and your overall offering becomes better and more enticing, you can up this percentage going forward. What we have here is we assume the newly signed up users for the free version out of the website visits. We then churn some of them that would stop using the product and delete their accounts. And then we also have a 2% estimate for our conversion to the paid subscription of our product. That way we arrive at our total active free users. And you see here that even though we're just starting with the paid subscription with our SaaS product, we might already have some free users from our beta or from our pilot projects, etc., that we can start from. So we have a starting point here, even though we don't have anything historical in terms of revenue and expenses. Then we grab the converted users from the free tier to the paid plan. We apply the same 35% churn to those, and we end up with the active paid users. Estimate the annual user fee, the revenue that we're generating per each user every year, and that's how we end up with our revenue. Then, similar to the subscription model, we'll follow the same approach of going through those assumptions and see how they will be reflected in our cost structure in our P&L going down the line. Another business model that's quite popular is the pay-as-you-go business model, where users are only paying when they're using specific features. So for example, here we have something similar to the Canva free model, where you have website visits, free tier sign up, free tier churn, similar to what we had. We're starting with 500 free users up till now. And what we're calculating is how many paid visuals will each user use on average. And this is something that will be hard to forecast if you don't have anything historical. I don't think it's a data point that's easy to find online for your competitors. But if there's a way to forecast that, that's a good way for estimating your revenue going forward. Then we have an average price per the visuals used, and that's how we arrive at our revenues. So in this business model, the users do not pay a subscription, so we have less churn, and we are able to get more traction more quickly, and our revenue comes from whenever those users are using some paid visual. We also have the perpetual license business model, or the lifetime deal. This has become really popular through services like AppSumo, where you can list your products. Let's say it's a subscription-based model, as we have here, with the same pricing tiers and everything, but we also offer a lifetime deal, which is in fact the perpetual license business model. So here we're assuming that apart from our churning clients, we have another movement in the number of clients, and that's clients opting for the perpetual license. Those are clients that instead of paying this amount per year, decide to go for a lifetime deal, pay 5,000 and don't have to pay a subscription again. We reduce the active paying users by that amount, which reduces our revenue from the pricing tiers, but we also have our lifetime deals revenue, which is the users that opted for a perpetual license multiplied by the 5,000 lifetime deal. So as a quick recap, we have the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach. I don't know what you responded in the comments below, but the top-down approach is less desirable because it relies on external factors, and the bottom-up approach is more grounded within the business, and we have more control over the assumptions that we're applying here. Most people generally prefer the bottom-up approach, but in specific situations, the top-down approach is the way to go, especially when we have little to no information about what we can actually do within the business. And even when working with the bottom-up approach, it's a good idea to have the same calculation from a top-down perspective, just to make sure that those are close to each other. And it's also a great reasonability check for your model. So if you do your bottom-up approach and you get to a revenue that's like 15% of the total market, it probably would be quite unrealistic. So whenever possible, when you're working on a bottom-up approach, do a top-down calculation as well, just to make sure that everything looks reasonable. In terms of a business model for a SaaS startup, the most common ones are the subscription model, the freemium model, the pay-as-you-go model, and the lifetime deal. As you saw here in our lifetime deal example, a lot of times we use a few of the business models together. For example, here in our perpetual license business model example, we are combining the subscription model with the lifetime deal model. Of course, you can go either way. You can just do lifetime deals. That was very popular for software back in the day. And in the past 2 years, I've seen more and more SaaS companies opt for this approach as their main business model. So there's certainly somewhat of a shift in this direction, and it's a business model that you should consider and look into when figuring out your SaaS product and what would be the best way to monetize it. So those were the most common business models that SaaS companies use, and the most common ways to forecast those in Excel, especially for new startups that are just starting and don't have historical data that they can do statistical analysis on top of. Now that you have a solid foundation on how to forecast your revenue when you're starting your new SaaS business, take a look at this video, which is going to show you how you can forecast your entire income statement going forward based off of historical data, so that you'll be better prepared to pitch to investors or provide information to the bank or any other stakeholder for that matter.
Thank you guys for watching. Give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Also, don't forget to subscribe if you're not already, and maybe even punch the bell icon to receive notifications every time I upload a new video. Till then, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one.